first started making stickers, I didn't want to spend too much yet, so I just bought really basic sticker paper off eBay, this one. eBay is better and has more options than Amazon here in Australia, in my opinion. But the sticker paper that I use now is from Mumsy & Bub. I'll leave a link in the description. This one is a lot smoother. It's a bit hard to show you the difference in texture on camera, but you can see that the one I use now is a lot brighter white, and the texture is a lot smoother than this one. This one has more of a paper texture. And this one is about double the price of the original one that I bought, but honestly, I still think this one is a great place to start, and I still prefer it for a lot of my solid colored stickers because I feel like it holds the ink better than my newer one does. So I still actually do use these ones for some of my stickers, especially my circle stickers, but for most of my sticker sheets, this is what I use. So even though the color does print out better on this sticker paper, the resolution does suffer a little bit. So if you have really detailed illustrations, I would go for something a little bit better. If you're outside of Australia, most people just go with online labels, but the shipping to Australia is really expensive. So this is an Australian company that I found, and I really like their sticker paper. I personally prefer matte sticker paper, but glossy sticker paper is fairly easy and cheap to get too. I've just had a few problems printing onto glossy sticker paper because the stickers always turned out to have a purplish tint on it. I don't know if it was just that particular brand of glossy paper, but all that means if you want to use glossy paper is that you just need to spend more time tweaking your printer settings until it's close to what's actually on your computer. And I'll come back to printer settings later. I have an iPad Pro 11 inch and Apple Pencil 2, but really any iPad or Apple Pencil combo will work, or any other stylus that you've got. You don't need to have an iPad Pro to make stickers. I illustrate most of my stickers in an app called Procreate, which I highly recommend, and I really, really enjoy it. I'm not an expert by any means in Procreate, so I honestly have no idea if I'm using the best settings, but the canvas size I use is 4000 by 5500 px pixels at 300 dpi. I couldn't really tell you why I have these settings, to be honest. I just wanted a canvas size as big as possible in case I ever wanted to turn one of my stickers into a vinyl sticker. A bigger size just means it's more versatile for me, and since I usually turn them into digital stickers as well, it's nice to have them at a good resolution. So here I am just finishing up my cat stickers, which I started last week, but thought I would finish it on camera just to show you my process. My favorite brushes are 6B pencil for lettering, outlines, details, and sometimes for just coloring in for that sketchy pencil look. Jasinski ink for coloring, but that brush has disappeared and I can't seem to find it, so I haven't used that one in a while. Gloaming, it's a new favorite for coloring, which I think has a little bit more texture than Jasinski ink. And also the ink brushes I bought in a brush set from Design Cuts, which I'll leave a link to in the description box. And I also use Monoline for sticker outlines. As I tend to make a lot of mistakes, I am someone that likes to use a lot of layers, more than necessary usually, but if you don't already, I highly recommend getting used to it. It's better safe than sorry, and it's like an extra layer of protection against mistakes, and it means you can easily make changes without affecting the background, for example. I probably picked up this habit as a photographer in Photoshop, making color changes, and it's important to have all your different changes on different layers instead of just relying on undo. So I think most people are pretty used to layers, but it is definitely a good habit to have, in my opinion. So as a basic rule of thumb, I keep colors and details on separate layers, and I always keep the white outline for the sticker outline on a separate layer. I love using Monoline for outlining the stickers because it has the streamline feature maxed out by default, which means the lines you draw are automatically smooth. I don't have the steadiest hand, so I really need this. My process for creating the sticker outlines is quite literally outlining the stickers on a layer behind your illustrations, trying to keep the line equidistant all the way around, but that doesn't always work. Then I make only the layer outline visible, and then I fill in the outline by just dragging the color in, and then basically outline again, because for some reason Monoline has edges that don't get filled in completely. If you make a mistake with the outline, like if you have one area that's a little bit wider than the rest, then you can just set your eraser brush to Monoline by holding it down, and then you'll see this message pop up saying erase with current brush. And then you just erase as normal, and it'll keep the same texture that you drew your outline with.
If you're designing solid stickers that you don't want a white outline for, then I made a video that walks you through how to create a bleed for your stickers in Photoshop. If you're wondering why I don't just print with a bleed directly from Design Space, it's because that feature doesn't work when you have a backing sheet behind your stickers, so you actually have to do it manually. I'll leave a link to that video in the description also if you're interested. If you don't have Photoshop or Affinity Photo or any other program, you can totally skip the step by importing your backing sheet directly into Procreate and just illustrating on top of it to figure out the layer of your stickers as you illustrate. I don't think it's necessary to have a separate program on your computer. It's just so nice to have, especially if you're going to use it for something else. But you can absolutely just make your entire sticker sheet on Procreate. I obviously like making things harder for myself, so I export the sticker sheet as a PNG file and airdrop this to my laptop where I drag it into Affinity Photo. I just like the flexibility of doing it this way because it's easier for me to do it on my laptop. I use the same backing sheet for all of my stickers. It's just a simple white one with round corners and my logo at the top, so I open the same file every time, then I open the PNG stickers as a separate document. It's super simple to make the round corners in Affinity Photo, which is basically the same steps in Photoshop. The easiest way to do it is to select the shape button, and then if you click this little arrow down here, it'll open up a menu of all different shapes. Both Photoshop and Affinity Photo have the same thing, but you want to select rounded rectangle, and then you can just draw this on your canvas. And you can change the curve of the corners really easily in Affinity Photo by just dragging it out. In Photoshop, you'll need to go to the Window Properties, and then you'll see these corner symbols where you can just drag on top of the icon, left or right, to get the curve that you want, or you can just change the values in here. Just make sure that this linking icon is selected, which makes sure the corners are linked and will change proportionally. So I just want to import my photos now. I'm dragging my PNG file to the menu bar and it'll import it as a separate document. What I do is I select the stickers one by one so I can play around with the layout as I go. I like to do this by selecting the brush selection tool. Nope, sorry, it's called the selection brush tool. And then you can just click on the sticker and it'll make a quick selection. But I like to kind of just draw around to make sure the entire sticker is selected, because sometimes you'll have some stray pixels around the outside you could lose. And then I just copy and paste onto my backing sheet. So technically resizing it affects the quality of the image, but if it's imported as a smart object, which is the default in Photoshop and in Affinity Photo, it should be fine. And I personally haven't noticed a drop in quality when I print it. So I like this method and it works for me. You can correct me if I'm wrong if you really want to get technical about it, but I still really like this process and yeah, it works for me. Because my backing sheet is white, often I have to make another solid background layer in a different color just so I can see how close the stickers are and how close they are to the edge, because you can't actually see the white outline. Rearranging the stickers and making it all look pretty definitely takes me a long time. I do spend a lot more time than I should on this, but once I'm happy with it, I just hide the background and I export the stickers only on the transparent layer as a PNG file to upload onto Cricut Design Space. You need to keep your stickers on a separate layer to your backing sheet if you do have one, because Cricut needs to know where to cut around, and if you attach it to your backing sheet, it'll just look like one flat image to print and nothing to cut. So here I've just imported it and you can see it's transparent, Cricut knows where the edges are. I always click complex when I'm importing stickers just because you want to save all the colors. Everything looks fine, so I click add. And because I've already made my backing sheet and uploaded it before, I'm just going to search and insert that as well. So now we're back on the canvas, and the size of your backing sheet is totally up to you. It depends how big you want to make it, but mine, just for reference, is 11 centimeters across and the height automatically adjusts to about 14.9. The size of the stickers kind of varies depending on the width of the stickers, but I usually make the width around 10, somewhere around there. To make sure your stickers and backing sheet are aligned, you can just draw a box over the images to select it on the canvas, click on align, and then click center horizontally. And then I had to move it back to 0, 0 because Cricut moved it. So as it is right now with just these two layers, it'll kiss cut your stickers, but it'll also just kiss cut the entire sticker sheet. So we want to completely cut out the sticker sheet, but we want Cricut to do that for us. So what I did here was just duplicate the backing sheet three times. Three is the number that seems to work for me. Set the fill to no fill, so it'll turn gray, and on the side you can see that the layers have changed to cut. Then I center it by clicking on align center. Then I send it to the back by clicking on arrange center back. And then I just move it behind the backing sheet by putting it at position 00. So now that we've got one side done, all we need to do is draw a box over all of these layers to select it and then duplicate it. I always put my second sticker sheet 11.5 centimeters across. This is a pretty arbitrary number. You could put it closer or further if you wanted. This just fits nicely on an A4 page for me and leaves enough room for the Cricut to cut around both. Now I'm selecting everything on the canvas and clicking on attach. This keeps everything together but still keeps them as separate layers, and you can easily detach, but it just tells Cricut to print and cut exactly as it appears on your canvas. Now I click on the green make it button in the top right, which takes me to the preview. I click continue, and then this is the screen where you'll connect your Cricut and print your stickers. Click on send to printer and a window will pop up. I toggle off add bleed because we don't need it for stickers with a white outline, and then I toggle on use system dialog, which opens up your actual printer settings so you can make more fine-tuned adjustments. If your design space is anything like mine, once you press print, it'll actually load the printer pop-up behind this window, which took me hours before I figured it out, so you'll have to minimize this window to see the pop-up. For the best quality print, set your print quality to the highest setting that you can and try to match the paper. This took me months of trial and error and wasted sticker paper before I found the right settings, so it's okay if you get it wrong the first time, but hopefully you can find someone else with the same printer and maybe using the same paper that you can copy their settings. For my printer, Epson XP442, I use Epson matte as the paper setting, the print quality set to high quality, and because my printer always seems to give a slight magenta cast, in color options I have selected manual settings, opened advanced settings at the bottom, and please keep in mind that this is probably very specific to my printer and paper, but I thought I'd show you anyway because it took me a long time to figure out the right color settings. I have selected Adobe RGB as the mode, 2.2 for gamma, and I reduced magenta by 2 to get rid of that magenta cast. It's subtle, but it definitely is there. If you have an Epson printer and you can't access these advanced settings, then you may need to click on Epson color controls in color matching. Before you print, don't forget to save your current settings as a preset just in case it is the one. As you can see, I've got many other presets where I've kind of failed and then I haven't figured out how to delete it yet. So now you can press print to send it to your printer, but don't forget to load sticker paper first. If you're having issues with the second sticker sheet not cutting accurately like I am, see my previous video about a trick I used to fix this, because this is the point where you need to go back and do that. Otherwise, if you're one of the lucky ones who happens to have a Cricut machine that actually cuts accurately, then just ignore this and stay on the printing and cut page. Once you're back on this page, click I've already printed and it'll load the rest of the settings. I use sticker paper removable, which is a Cricut default setting. When I first got my Cricut machine, I had to set the blade pressure to less because I guess the blade was just too new and it was too sharp and it would just cut straight through the sticker paper. So just keep that in mind. And depending on your sticker paper also, you may need to change either the cut pressure, make a custom one, or change the blade pressure to less. When you're ready to load the mat and the stickers, hold the mat flat against the rollers and press the button with the arrow to load it, and then press the Cricut button once it starts flashing to start cutting. When it's done, you can press the flashing arrow button to unload the mat. Even though my mat is technically a strong grip one, it isn't that sticky now because I've intentionally worn it out, but it still does the job, so it's easy for me to peel off the sticker paper. The mat will be super sticky when you first use it, but remember to always peel the mat away from the sticker sheet, otherwise the sticker sheet will curl, which is not a good thing. And always remember to put the plastic cover back onto the mat or it'll lose its stickiness. Take it from my experience. So that is my process for making sticker sheets using Procreate, Affinity Photo, and my Cricut machine. I hope this video helped you get started and answered some of your questions. Again, this is just one way of doing it, not the only way, but if you have any other questions, just leave a comment below and I will do my best to help you out. Thanks so much for watching. Bye. Thank you.